what you've done with us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that your promises are true. You're a God who loves, a God who transforms, a God that takes people from all the corners of the earth and brings them together. Just like it's going to happen at the end, the table of the Lamb, the feast of the Lamb. People from every country, from every ethnicity, every language and tongue and group will be there around the table. So Father God, we just thank you for giving us a glimpse of that all these years. We thank you, Lord, for 32 years. Who would have known, or who would have guessed? I want to thank you, Lord, especially for the young group that just led us in praise and worship, Lord, this morning. Thank you, Lord. We just praise you, Lord, because you have prepared a new generation, Lord.
Hallelujah.
We go on for another 32 years, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Father God, we just thank you. Thank you, and we bless your name, Lord, because you are God. And that you will not give your glory to another, Lord. You are seated on the throne, no one else. And you command that it happens.
Hallelujah.
And Father God, you seek people that will open their hearts to you.
Yes.
And be earnest with you.
Yes.
And love you with all their hearts. And worship you in spirit and in truth. And then you do everything else, Lord. We bless you and we thank you, Lord, for bringing us together. We thank you, Lord, for all the struggles you got us through. We thank you, Lord, for all the people that you administered to in this church, Lord, the last 32 years. For those that have been healed, for those that have been encouraged, those that have been born again into the kingdom of God, for those that have been discipled, Lord, for those that have grown in the faith and grown in works and righteousness, Father God, we thank you, Lord, that have grown the knowledge of the Lord. We thank you, Father God, for all the things you have done.
Yes.
Oh God, we just praise your name, Lord, because to you belongs all the glory. To you belongs all the honor, Lord. You alone have done this, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you have taken us along for the ride. We thank you, Father God, even the times that we were hesitant, even the times we were lacking faith and lacking courage and lacking all the resources that we needed, Father God, we thank you that you took us through.
Right.
That we may have songs to sing.
Yes, yes. Thank you, Jesus.
Just like this one we just sang.
Yes.
The enemy has been defeated. Thank you, Father God, that you have put Satan under our feet. All authority in heaven and earth has been given to you, Lord Jesus. And you have commanded us to go and make disciples.
Yes. Yes.
Lord God Almighty, we have done this and we're doing it and we will do it and we'll continue to do it, Lord. Because you are God and your love endures forever. And your purposes,
yes,
and your plans, they're the only ones,
right,
that get done. So we thank you and we bless you, Lord. We give you the rest of this service. In Jesus' name, Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, welcome. So I want to welcome you. Are here by commission. I want to thank especially Margot, who usually is not able to worship with us.
Amen.
She and her mother is here. Welcome. We just want to thank the Lord for what He's done the last 32 years. And I just want to share a couple of things with you, and then we're going to go into more sharing. I also see in the back. You can't miss him, Mike and City. Pastor Mike. Pastor Mike has been a youth pastor for a number of years and has made a huge impact, especially in this guy here, and so many other kids. And he's such a great friend, and we'll continue to work together and talk and everything else. And so I asked him to come. He's actually left his own service at Foothills Community. You're going to hear about Foothills Community in a second. So I want to ask, I know he has to go back, so I'm going to ask Mike to come up and just share, and then I'll give my short message.
Sure. You know, when Henry told me yesterday about the celebration, I was so excited.
Amen.
And I wanted to find a way, whether my pastor gave me permission or not. He did, so the Lord was working. But, you know, I thought a lot about the impact that Agape and the people that are here have made in my life. And Amen. The consistent love that I felt. You know, we, my wife and I, Carla, and our son Mitchell was only a couple months old when we got here. And pretty much my kids were raised in the time that we were with you. And we have a deep and profound love for you. And even though I'm not here every Sunday, I think and I pray for you. And I take all the lessons that you guys have shown me so much in taking this stranger. And I felt, and I still feel, that I was home when I was here. I was with my family. You guys treated me as family consistently. And still, I still feel that. And whenever any opportunity comes up, I sing the praises of Agape Christian Church because our God is an awesome God.
Yes.
And He has done amazing things in your life, in the life of this church, all the people that have come. And just through my mind, I play through all the people that would come to youth group or go with us on our mission trips to the Native Americans, or on the fun times that we had up at Alpine Retreat Center, and the decisions that people made that impact their lives, whether they're here now or around the world. This church has had an amazing ministry, and I know in my heart, and the reason I'm so proud to celebrate with you is that it will continue.
Amen.
That God has blessed you. You know, I was looking through for a verse that I want to encourage you with because as I teach my eighth graders, I'm an eighth grade Bible teacher among other things, I try to let them understand that each moment, each day that God gives us is a gift.
Amen.
It's something to be cherished, not to look forward to tomorrow, but to right now. And to look around this room and to see these people and the tremendous amount of blessing that God has put together. For your pastor and all the people that support. And it's just amazing to me the consistency that is here, that is present, and from the blessing of God. And so let me just read this passage from Jeremiah 17. And this is what I think of when I think of Agape. It says, He is like a tree planted by water that sends out its root by the stream and does not fear when heat comes. For its leaves remain green. And is not anxious in the year of drought, for it does not cease to bear fruit. You do not cease to bear fruit. Your blessing goes way beyond this room and this place. And as Pastor Henry said, I'm ministering down at Foothills Community Church, and that's where I connected with Agape. So every Sunday when I go in, I pray for you. Because this just reminds me of where I began. And the day I think that my time at Agape probably had the most profound impact on me and my spiritual growth than any other time in my life, including Fuller, including anything else, was here. But that's because of God using you in our lives.
Amen.
So we love you, and my prayer and blessing is with you in the name of Jesus. Thanks for having me.
Amen.
It's a day of bragging, so I just want to ask our friend Mike, and where did you grow up to church? In church?
Hollywood Presbyterian Church.
Thank you, Mike. Do you want to love to?
I will.
And now I'm going to see Pat and Mike.
Margaret, do you have to leave early as well or no?
Yes?
We're going to ask Margaret to come up as well.
Well, this too is my home, and even though I'm not here every Sunday or long absences, we do go way back, and even the unfamiliar friends that I see here, I'm just praising God that we all share the same experience of love and encouragement and support from this church.
Yes.
And it's not just the church, it's also our pastor.
Yes.
And we can truly say pastors, because Reagan has made a tremendous impact on our lives as well as Henry. Yes. God has used these two people to guide us through difficult times in our community, but also in our personal lives. And we all have had occasion to experience God's strength in our lives through the words, through the encouragement, through life, experiencing life with them. And I praise God for the miracles that happen here.
Yes.
There has been a revolving door here for quite some time, but that doesn't mean those lives have gone. God has built something great in their hearts, and it will not return void.
Amen.
At some point, they will recognize and truly worship God as they used to here as well. So I am so thankful for this place, not just the tile and the landscaping, as many have participated in, but I thank you for the lives that have been benefited by this wonderful place, and I thank you, Henry and Ray.
Thank you. Thank you, Michael. Blessings. Okay, so we're going to talk about family. Okay, the church is family. Okay, I want you to say that the church is family. Okay. In fact, it's going to outlast your family and my family. You know, this is 32 years, and Ray and I were brought here because of a commitment to the National Health Service. I'm a physician, so I, you know, made a commitment when I was in med school. So we came, and we landed a job or a service in the Watts Health Foundation. But we had no idea what God was going to do next. It was a 2-year commitment, so we said goodbye to our parents and our friends and people that we grew up with in church in Boston, and said, it's just 2 years, we'll be right back, and everything was, you know, well and done. And then we came in 1980, and the first thing we did is start a youth group. That should have been the clue. But it was so natural for us to do because we grew up in the youth group. We were formed spiritually in the youth group. We had deep friendships. You know, we married in the youth group. Ray and I were in the same youth group. So, I mean, it was like 400 couples that married through the youth group. So it was like, that's life. This is the life that you have. But we were very still naive about how strong the bonds of church are compared to our nuclear family. And so what happened was, in 1980 when we came, we started a youth group in our own home. I was moonlighting actually at the Huntington Hospital in the ER. And I decided, well, you know, this is important, so I stopped moonlighting. And we started having a youth group and Bible study, and then we started taking trips, and you know, I'm not going to bore you with all the exciting and the problems and all that in the youth group, but it was really great. And then we started also meeting once a month. There was a meeting here already once a month that would meet at the Kefalas home on Sunday afternoon. It would be a time of worship and then a sermon for the Greeks in the area. And then also the great feast after that. Okay, so that happened every month. So we also joined that as well. And then we started meeting and going and visiting people, just not just, but George and Anna and me and Rhea, visiting other Greek Americans in the area. And after a while, we realized that there was a need and also a desire for a church. So we started the Greek Evangelical Church of Los Angeles. And one of the founding members is just coming through the door. Actually, two of the founding members coming through the door. It's Dean and Exi Papadakis. Let's give them a hand. We need a director. We just... Perfect timing, Dean. Thanks. Anyway, so that's what happened. We started a church. In fact, our first service, I think, was at the Methodist Church across from Fuller. Pretty soon, I started going to Fuller Seminary and all that, and you know, it became starting kind of serious stuff. And Brad and I had our arguments and all that about whether I should become a pastor or not. And we all know the answer to that. And so I went. Now, in September of 1980, we started the youth. September of 1981, the church was formed. We had elders come from Greece as well as from Boston and helped us start the church. In 1982, actually got our papers from the state and the country and the U.S. government. In 1993, you know, the church started basically focusing on Greek Americans in the area. And we were meeting at the Sierra Madre Women's Club. They had no idea that somebody was meeting there on Sundays, except that once a year, for 3 days, we would have the Greek Food Festival. And all of Sierra Madre would come down and be circles around the block waiting for this lucky and the oregano or
the park. The striped blue and white awnings outside are from that time, from the Greek Food Festival, so they keep us shade.
Yeah. So that's good stuff, right? So anyway, so it was really great, but what happened was we realized after a while, because we were doing Gringlish, you know, I was speaking Greek and then speaking English, and George Kefalos would also alternate preaching, we'd do the same thing, and it was getting boring and really difficult, and finally what happened was we decided that we need to have an English service. We decided that we had to, you know, our kids growing up were not really well-versed in Greek and all that, and friends they could not bring in, and anyway, so we started a Greek and English service. And in 93, we opened the doors to the community. We decided that this is a time to not be just Greek-minded, but actually open the doors to the community. And what a great growth of people coming in, Foothills Community Church. Foothills Community Church has been very, very key. It was actually before that we made that commitment, there was something going on about Foothills. It was a building that was not used. But because we made, I believe, because we made a commitment to open the church to the community, God first gave us the first church building to be able to rent. In fact, we were the only church there. Normally when you rent a church building, there's a primary church and then you're the secondary. So we had, you know, the full grounds, the full use of the building, and God really blessed us. You know, Mike was part of that group of pastors that helped us to do this. Now, I'm going to move quickly here. In 1993, we opened the doors to the community. In 99 and 2000 was actually one of the most difficult years in our church. We actually had on our Easter service with 250 people come. We're renting a building from Presbyterian Church across from PCC, Knox Presbyterian Church. Then the problem started. We had kind of a threefold issue that became a big problem when the church split. In 2000 was kind of the low year. But in 1999, we, through our contacts, Eva is a big part of this, we're able to connect with Fuller students, quote-unquote students. These are people who were pastors in their homeland. They came to Fuller to get, further in their degrees. And so anyway, that's how we got to meet Emmanuel and Leticia Bell, their family, and then Mary and Paul Cornelius. And we made a deal with them. Look, we don't want you to come to church and just sit in the back and be a member. We want you to be a leader in the church. Come and share the leadership with us, and then when you guys are ready to go into your mission field, we're going to support you.
Now we're at Holiday Inn Express.
That was at Holiday Inn, we moved into Holiday Inn Express. And that was the time that, you know, these families came, and we were down from, I think, 50 people to 150, and it was an amazing time. And then the third change in Agape was between 1999, 2000, we were fighting for equality and unity, and then in 2000, partnering with the Fuller students, and then in 2006, moving here to Northwest Pasadena. Amen. Now, this was, for me, it was not just opening our doors to the community, it was opening our hearts in our homes to the community, the homeless, all those people that needed help, and that was the major reason we came. In 2006, when we actually moved to Northwest Pasadena, we were able to purchase this place. And then in 2011, we were able to come in and worship as a church here. So now, 2011 through 2012 have been difficult years because we were struggling with unity. You know, unity has been always the issue. And I'm glad to tell you that now, 2013, we are united and we're ready for the next big thing. Okay? I just want to one thing. God shaped and stretched us in ways that we had no clue we're going to be stretched and grown. The mystery of the church is something that I want us to focus on this morning. Here's what Paul writes. This grace was given to me, he says, to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, which for ages past was kept hidden. God, that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms. Church is huge. As I said, it would outlast your own nuclear family. But also, more importantly, God uses the church to change you, to transform you. Yes, parents have a responsibility to teach their children, to be able to discipline their children, to be able to help them to grow, to be mature men and women. But the church does a lot more than that. The church focuses on the spiritual side and does an amazing job to grow the spirit of every human being that is earnestly seeking to know God in Christ. So God wanted to make known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places, according to his eternal purpose, which he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord, in him and through faith in him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. For this reason, Paul writes to the Ephesians, I kneel before the Father from whom his whole family in heaven and earth derives his name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, that is agape love, may have power together with the saints to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. The church is a spiritual, cultural, social structure that reflects the heavenly family. It's so much more than our own nuclear families. It's beyond my family and your family. It's the original family and the basis of every family in heaven and earth. So when anyone deces, this is the church of Christ, when anyone forsakes the brethren, they are forsaking Christ and his heavenly family. Even Jesus, when he was here on earth, had no patience for people that would put family first. In fact, one of the most amazing promises that I latched on early on when we came to California and left our homes and our parents and everybody else was this promise that Jesus has in Luke 18, 29 through 30. He says, I tell you the truth, no one who has left home or wife or brothers or mother or father or children for the sake of the kingdom of God will fail to receive 100 times as much. Now, you may say, well, I know, we all know we're going to be in heaven, and it's going to be so amazing. Yes, that's true. That's the big bonanza, okay? But that's not what Jesus promised. He said, 100 times as much in this age, on this earth, in this age to come. So, when God says, I'm going to do something great, and I want to show off to the heavenly spiritual realm who I'm doing with this, this is what he does. The Church of Jesus Christ, our Lord, is for every kind of person on earth, open to all, no matter what color, ethnicity, socioeconomic status, or religious background. Amen. I want to warn you that one of the things that God is starting to talk to me about is inviting gay couples into the church. Okay, I know some of you, what are you talking about? But you have to think about it. Would Jesus have approached the gay couple? Would he have talked to them?
Yes.
Would he have loved them? Did he die for them?
Yes.
Okay, is this a church of Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. I'm proud to declare all of you today that Agape has done that, and we have the scars to prove it. But more importantly, we have been blessed tremendously. Because we have been transformed through the grace of Christ. After all, if you deal out grace all the time, what happens? if you deal with money all the time, what happens? The banks deal with money all the time, right? They make money. A lot of that money sticks in their hands, okay? When you deal with honey all the time, your hands are full of honey. You can lick your fingers and get plenty of honey all day long. I mean, it's the same thing with the grace of God that is far beyond any of those things. I want us to have a chance to be able to share what God has done in us and through us at Agape. So I'm going to ask Ray to come in and start sharing, and then just take it, take your time and come in to say what God has put in your heart.
A little bit, come on. Okay, just a little bit. 32 years of a love affair. Mm-hmm. Is what it is.
Thank you,
honey. And I got into it because of this love affair. Okay? I've shared this already. Preacher's kid, did not want to be a preacher's wife. Married a doctor, did not marry a pastor. We came to California, medical reasons, fine, cool, 2 years. But youth group, youth group is fun, right? It is fun. The kids in youth group were just something a few years older than me. I was 22 when we came. 22, it's a whole life, 22. And a lot of them were just 2-3 years older than me. Most of them were students coming from Greece. They were in for college, in graduate school. We had fun. We would meet at the condo in El Molino. We would go camping. Yosemite, there's lots of pictures. But it was fun. I could handle fun. And then this guy wanted to go to Fuller, and he wanted his MDiv. And I'm thinking, MDiv sounds a little bit like ministry, but okay, you're preaching, go with it, okay? And then 10 years later, he wants to be ordained, and it's like, okay, now even I understand that ordination means now you're going to be a pastor, now I'm the pastor's wife. And I remember when we moved from the women's club to Foothills, which is when we basically opened the door to English-speaking people. We split the services. There was the Greek service, which was a small group of people, 20 people, 30 people. And then the English ministry all of a sudden started to blossom. Well, I mean, no surprise, because everybody's English-speaking around you, okay? So that all of a sudden started to grow. And I remember, I lost my train of thought.
All right.
Pastor.
Oh, and I remember. That's right. Thank you. And I remember being in Foothills, and as Henry said, we had all these Fuller guys come, and there was Finian Ebuehi, tall Nigerian big man, right, with his wife Elizabeth, who seemed very serious to me, who talked English in a very formal fashion. And I remember him saying, "Oh, First Lady, where's the First Lady? This is the First Lady." And I looked at him and I said, "I'm sorry, I am not First Lady. Rhea, and I'm not a pastor's wife, I'm just Rhea." And I remember that, and he reminds me to this day, and it has been, it's like how you kill a frog, you put it in cold water, slowly you heat up the water to the frog. I became a first lady now I'm like, hey, I'm the first lady, and then he was like, no. So it's been a love affair that has been growing, and it is, I feel so honored to have been brought into this thing. I did it fighting. I did it not wanting to. It's the best thing we've done in our lives.
Amen.
Children have come and children have gone. And here we are.
Amen.
And I'm reminded of scripture where you start with Adam, and then you have Moses, and you have Abraham and Jacob. And the characters keep changing, but the love affair of God with his people continues.
Amen.
And I am privileged to be part of that big picture. And I do believe it's a big picture. And I know many times I've struggled with that, what Margaret talked about, the revolving door. Because in our ministry, and we're very different in our personalities. I'm very kind of in your face, kind of, chit-chat is a little bit tough for me, you know, I want to talk about your deep problems. And I've had the privilege to do that with many, many, many people who've come in through the door. And we've had strong relationships and get close. And then for some reasons, sometimes they're good reasons and sometimes they're bad reasons, people go off, okay? And so, as a woman who am very connected with people, it's been tough. It's been tough. It's like you're in the home, you're doing the ministry, and it keeps changing. But I have to tell you that I wouldn't trade this.
Yes.
Because as we sat here and worshiped, okay, our worship styles have changed dramatically. Yes. We fought. I remember when we first became Greek English.
Yes, time is done.
Greek English, you know, we wanted to sing English and the Greeks wanted us to sing Greek. So we wanted to sing, you know, do part Greek and part English. And I remember we used to do that when we were English speaking congregation at Foothills. And I remember when Gina Hernandez, she had just started coming, before she got married, she had just come into church. And Henry was officiating communion. And he did it in English and then he did it in Greek. And so she turns around and she says to her friend, you can tell me this was a Pentecostal church and they speak in tongues. So
I have no words to say. I met Leah when she was in her late 20s. Henry was young, 30s. through soccer, Henry played with my husband John. And was it all Greek? All Greek.
Greek team. Yeah.
And I fell in love with his beauty, with her long, gorgeous ponytail. And then I was going to the Sarah Maduka Congregational Church.
Can you shrink a little bit? You're not
Can I shrink a little bit? And so I would go back and forth to the Sarah Maduka Women's Club when they would have the special events with the rest of my Greek friends. So then when my children left Sarah Maduka Congregational Church, I also left there and I came part to be at the Agape Church. I've been in love with Henry and Rhea for many years. Henry is not only, and Rhea too, has helped me heal emotionally, physically, and spiritually. More than guys that I know. When John and I were struggling with our son's drug addiction and schizophrenia, Henry and Rhea and a lot of other friends who are here embraced us, came every week and prayed for us, for healing, for Christopher, for us. So hard to tell you how much I appreciate and I love you both. Rhea, and I don't think you know what it meant when you once upon a time had a hard time feeding your own families and you took another family into your home, fed them, loved them, cared for them, clothed them. And I remember the young gentleman named Larry who died in our church, a homeless man. And you took him in, fed him, and gave him a place to sleep. And he died shortly after, and Henry and Rhea gave him a funeral. And you've done that to many people, not just the family you took in and Larry that passed away. But you may think nothing, people don't understand, people don't love you. No, people know the heart. That's the problem with the two of you. You have such a heart for people that people just don't get you. And not only have you strengthened my faith, but you have strengthened a lot of people's faith too, whether they tell you or not. And I'm so grateful for the both of you. And I love you all, and I'm so glad you're here today. Thank you.
Well, I just have to say thank you all for praying for me for the surgery. I have made it through.
Yeah.
That was good. And in fact, I was in the operating room. I was so nervous. This poor guy that was next to me, I don't know what his job was, but I was squeezing his hand and it was turning red. I was like this. But thank you. I'm doing very well. Yeah. Doing very well. So. But I just wanted to say I'm so thankful for this church because when I came, I had a lot of problems. And I remember Rhea, she was so sweet. I had these clothes. We had just moved into our place. And I had boxes and boxes and boxes of clothes in different sizes because I always thought I'd get down to size 8. Well, that's not going to happen, you know? So I had all these clothes. And Rhea came and helped me unpack it and organize it. And she took all this time. I think like 3 Wednesdays for 2-3 hours. And it was a lot of work, and she was very patient with me. And just when it's a church and you come here, and I've been healed and delivered of many things, of some psychiatric problems, and have just received so much love, and love could heal so much. And I just love both Henry and Rhea and what they've done. And this church is neat because it's not a huge, huge church, so you know everybody. I see Julia Dean, and it's like Little House on the Prairie. When you get to actually see the pastor and the pastor's
wife. See what happens.
You can have communication with them. So I just want to
thank you. Thank you, Paige.
You're welcome.
Thank you. I asked Joe to come up and share a couple of things, because not only one of the elders and the handsomest Greek man alive. Okay, but also he's been a friend and a partner in the ministry, and it's just amazing what God has done. We're running out of time, so we're gonna take this outside. But first, we need to finish the service. So I'm gonna have George say a couple of things, and then we're going to have our collection, and we'll close, and we'll go outside for the celebration, and we'll continue the sharing, okay? Because I know a lot of you have a lot to say, but I don't want us to be a problem to the next church that's coming in.
Praise God, first thing to be here this morning. God, it's really amazing me what the way He was working on in my life.
Yeah.
I came here when I was 23 years old with $25 in my pocket in Philadelphia with nobody. Mm-hmm. One little suitcase and no language. But praise God, I'm here today and I met family. What I'm trying to tell you, I'm not taking too much time. God has a story for each one of us, and He has a schedule and He has plans. So ask us to open our eyes to see what He has for us and to praise Him, to say thank you.
Yes.
And then He's going to show us more things in our life.
Yeah.
I met family here, I met good friends here. I have, usually I don't have time, I mean, difficulty to make friends, but to make good friends from God is a different story.
Yes.
The true friends, like Henry and Red, even if I, sometimes I don't feel to have them with me sometimes. Especially when he called me, I was in the hospital with a knee. George, I made them to come over to visit you to see how you're doing. He says, Henry, I don't want you. I want to be alone. But he still loved me, he still called me and visit me and encourage me. And that's from God.
Amen.
Yeah, that's from God. So let's open our hearts in our life and see what God has for us and give thanks to Him. Okay, that's
amazing. Yes. Thank you, George. I think I actually have Dean bring XC up front just for a second. And we're going to get ready to have our collection. I also want to, while X is coming up, I just want to kind of give you a glimpse of what Agape has been. We have Ken Stalker, who is an elder of our church, who comes from a Mormon background, from Utah. And he's out fishing now with a couple of guys from the church.
Yes.
One is from Madagascar, newlywed. The other one is from here. He's a Latino, Eliud. I mean, it's for me. I think that's, to me, it's just such a great thing to be able to. What else? Where else can you find that? That kind of diversity, that kind of love and affection. You know?
Yeah.
Okay. Exie has always complained to me because I made a mistake when we first started the church, and we had, I think, 17 members. They were the founding members. And I made a mistake of not putting her name down. Bad mistake. But now, actually, I want to let everybody know, after 32 years, actually, okay, used to be 5 years old then. Yes, are you five? So you're now 37. Right? Am I exaggerating? No, I'm just telling everybody that you're one of the founding members of Agape. One of the 17 founding members of Agape. So we want to thank the Lord for your love for us, and for your support all these years. And I'm actually, just for everybody to know, I'm number two son. Okay? There's number one son right there, and number two son right here. Now, I want to thank you for being one of my fathers that God has given me. After you keep mine.
Is it yours?
I didn't understand everything. But I just love you guys. That's all I can say.
Amen.
I love the church. And I feel that you not only home here that I feel with the Lord. And I love Henry.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Now we're going to have our offering.
Food.
Oh.